again to your 2016 convocation. Will everyone please rise for the presentation of the colors by Eagle Pass High School, Texas 92nd Air Force Junior ROTC. Now we have the Pledge of Allegiance to be led by Student Council President from Eagle Pass High School, Marcus Appleton. Please remain standing for our salute to the Texas flag by CC Wynn Student Council President Pablo Garcia.
The Texas flag, I pledge allegiance to the Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Please remain standing for national anthem to be sung by CC Wynn High School Silver Lion Amanda Lee Martin.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof to the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave for the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Again to your 2016-2017 EPISD convocation. This year, once again, we have been blessed with gracious donors that have gifted us with some amazing door prizes to be handed out. And I think to get this party started, we should give one out. The first one will be an iPad Air, donated by the District Service Center Directors and Mr. Robert Serna, District Attorney. Please direct yourself to the screen to see who our lucky winner is. Jessica Chancy Villegas. Please report to the front row and collect your prize. Congratulations. We will be continuing to give these out sporadically through the rest of convocation. Now, we are here to kick off this school year in style. And to remind you that coming back to work doesn't mean the party is over. EPISD is all about doing best for our students and obviously for our staff. So to remind you that working at IPC is always a fiesta, we have a special treat for you.
Well, good morning. All I can say is, wow. I wonder which school has the most spirit. Thank you. Before I get started, let's give a big hand to the drum line, Eagle Pass High School CCO Win, the Texas 92nd Junior ROTC, Pablo Garcia, Marcus Appleton, CC Win, Eagle Pass High Student Council President, the great voice of Amanda Martin. And last but not least, the CC Win Eagle Pass High School dance team. Are we awake now? Before I start, I want to recognize and thank our school board members for always recognizing the outstanding work of our employees, which this year translated into a 3.1 salary increase, a salary equity adjustment, an increase in starting pay for professionals. Let's give them a big hand. Starting with Lupita Winton, Board President. Hilda Martinez Caballero, Board Vice President. Dr. Hector Alvarez, Board Secretary. Glenna Purcell, Trustee. Ignacio Salcedo, Trustee. Humberto Torralba, Trustee. And Rudolph Bowles, Trustee. At this time, I want to welcome you back, let you know that while you were having fun in the sun, catching some rays, and enjoying the time off that you deserve, we here at EPISD miss you. I am glad that you are back. Every year, our family seems to get bigger and bigger. And with that being said, we have 21 new teachers, and at this time, please stand up, our new teachers. There's one, two, right over there. I want you to know that you have just joined the greatest group of people I have ever known. That's the EPISD family. Throughout your new journey with EPISD, you will find that your colleagues will be your greatest asset and resource and give you advice and guide you through your journey in education. I want you to know that you join a school district in which all the campuses met standard as per TEA on the accountability ratings. Let's give yourselves a big hand. Congratulations. Congratulations to the teachers, the principals, the directors, and the deputy superintendents for all that they do. With that being said, I believe we do have a video. Welcome back to our house. I think Dancing with the Stars has nothing on us, right? I never seen Mr. Titus move like that. Let's give a big hand for Mr. Titus. I know I said this before, but I work with the best employees of all of Region 20. This past school year was outstanding. Was outstanding. We excelled in UIL, in academics, in athletics, and the fine arts. We had a tremendous student council that showed all over Texas, showed Texas what leaders are all about. Our band is always continuing to dominate, and of course our athletes have break records and shatter misconceptions. And all of this is possible because of the work that you do in the classrooms Our district is able to send our students out into the world to do all these amazing extracurricular things because you make sure that they first learn. Last year, I asked you to go back to the basics, and I challenge for you to go back to the basics to teach you at its core, and I applaud you because you did. This year, we have a new motto, a new slogan, and it's whatever it takes. When your original plan fails, there shouldn't be a reason why everything else you plan has to fail also. Rick DeVos once said, the only thing that stands between a person and what they want in life is the will to try it and the faith to believe it is possible. And nothing is impossible when you do whatever it takes. For those of you who have been watching the Summer Olympics, how many medals were won by people like you and me who refused to give up and they did whatever it takes? We saw Michael Phelps and Katie Ledecky in swimming. We saw Simone Biles and the Final Five gymnastics. We saw Usain Bolt from Jamaica in the 100 and 200 meter runs. And of course, my favorite, the South African runner, Wade van Heerden, who broke the record that stood for 17 years in the 400 meters run. But more impressively, his coach was great-grandmother of 74 years old. A teacher. There are countless of athletes who did very well because of their mentality to do whatever it takes. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I am here to tell you that education is our Olympics. And you, the teachers and the students, can also be the winners at the end of the year if you adopt the same philosophy of do whatever it takes. Eagle Pass Independent School District is a district that never settles for mediocrity. When you walk into your classroom on Monday and you see it filled with students, they'll sporting their new tennis shoes and shirts that say, I saw the movie Ghostbusters. Remember that each one of those students is different. They all have different styles, and they need to be nurtured and explored. All we need to do is whatever it takes to get the message to the students. And I know that you will because EPIZ has the best. Thank you so much. God bless. Have a successful school year.
Thank you, Mr. Lozada, for those moving words. It is now at this time that I recognize our distinguished guest. We just heard from Superintendent of Schools, Ms. Rebecca Gonzalez. Also from the District Service Center, we have Ismael Mijares, Deputy Superintendent for Business and Finance. Samuel Mijares, Deputy Superintendent for Curriculum and Instruction. Eduardo Trevino, Deputy Superintendent for District Operations. And Jesus Garcia, Executive Director for Human Resources. Also from the district office, will all directors, coordinators, please rise to be recognized. From our campuses, will all early childhood principals please rise. Our elementary principals. And secondary principals, please rise. Last but not least, all assistant principals and IOs, please rise for recognition. This morning, we have a very special guest, Mr. Billy Riggs. Billy has been speaking publicly for more than 30 years and privately since the age of 2. He has sold more than 200,000 recordings of his speeches. He's the author of nearly 250 unique recordings, as well as 4 books, the latest of which is entitled Meditudes. He's earned 2 master's degrees, both magna cum laude, one of which is education. He resides in Austin, Texas, and is one of only 1,000 speakers in America to be recognized as a certified speaking professional. Billy was a multimillionaire by age 18, but only in Turkish lira. His name regularly appears on the cover of Time magazine, but only on the address label. He has three children, two of them are adopted, and he's still seeking a good home for the third. Billy is also a world-class illusionist who has been featured on 10 cruise ships and has performed before audiences as large as 20,000 people. He has appeared and disappeared at the MGM Grand Hotel in Las Vegas, Caesars in Lake Tahoe, and the Tropicana in Atlantic City. He appeared in his own 90-minute television special, The Magic of Attitude, but he doesn't like being called an illusionist, because he's far more interested in reality than illusions. That's why they call him not an illusionist, but a disillusionist. But the accomplishment he is proudest of is that he is an Eagle Scout and the Scoutmaster of his son's Boy Scout troop in Austin, Texas. Please, ladies and gentlemen, welcome the world's first and only disillusionist, Billy Riggs.
Bring the volume down a little bit, and I'll talk louder. Buenos dias, ¿cómo están ustedes? ¿Cómo están sus vacaciones de verano? He estado estudiando el español hace 15 años, pero solo por mi cuenta. Y por eso hablo bien el español, pero no entiendo nada. So, I'm going to speak English. Everybody, let's start with an experiment. Do this. Now everybody do this. Now everybody do this, and everybody do this. Now everybody do this, everybody do this. Are you participating back there? You think this is like TV. It's not. I can see you too. Now everybody wiggle your thumbs like this. Everybody wiggle your pinkies like this. Now at the count of three, without letting go, do this. One, two, three. Any questions so far? Can we have some house lights up, please? I still want to be able to see eyeballs out here. And please put my computer on the screen there. Well, if you don't have any questions, I do. You see, as a magician, my mind is very keenly in tune with the mysteries that surround us all. In fact, for you David Letterman fans, I have compiled today's top 10 list in the category Great Unanswered Questions of Our Day. Number 10, where do Walmart employees go when you need assistance? Can we please put my computer on the screen? Number 9, why did kamikaze pilots wear helmets? Number 8, why do they call hemorrhoids hemorrhoids when they could be called asteroids? Number 7, does a dyslexic dog think he's God? By the way, the volume of my computer went way down too, so please turn the volume up and put the PC on the screens, if you will. Number 6, why do people who can barely walk always wear jogging suits? Number 5, does a beer belly count as six-pack abs? Number 4, is a vegetarian allowed to eat animal crackers? Number 3, why do they put artificial lemon in lemonade and real lemon in dishwashing detergent? Number 2, if you have a yeast infection, can you still attend Passover? And finally, the number one unanswered question of our day, When blondes have more fun, do they know it? Well, this morning through the Art of Illusion, we will attempt to answer a much more important question. It is this: how can you provide a level of education to the students of Eagle Pass that is positively magical? And at the risk of giving away the ending, it's all about doing whatever it takes. I will now levitate my assistant. It's all about getting on the ball in four specific areas of your life. Now, what goes on in your head is of critical importance, because what you think about has an almost magical way of becoming reality around you. By the way, you know how some entertainers snort coke before they perform? I drink it. I tried snorting it once, but I almost drowned. And the carbonation tickles my nose. Take, for example, this Coke can. Let me empty it out completely. Get every drop out of there. Would you do me a favor, sir? Just touch the can. Would it be fair to say that that's room temperature? It's been sitting out all night. Just to establish a baseline, I would like you to take a mental snapshot of this Coke can. The hole in the top, the indented bottom, and the perfectly cylindrical shape. And now, I'm simply going to crush this can, and I want us to see if we can, by the power of what we envision, send it back through time 30 seconds. Envision it perfectly cylindrical as it was just half a minute ago. And let's see if anything changes. You see, this is the way that change takes place in your life. Did you hear that? You begin to envision different things, which results in subtle changes in your behavior, and you get slightly better results. At first, you're not even sure that it happened. I want you to memorize that dent and tell me if anything changes. Did you hear that? Oh, is that dent getting smaller? At first, you're not sure that it happened. You begin to rationalize it away. I think that dent is much smaller than it was just a moment ago. After a while, the differences are so stark that you know you couldn't have imagined it, but then you try and say, well, it was just coincidence. It had nothing to do with what was going on in my head. Is that dent smaller than I walked by a moment ago? It's almost completely gone, isn't it? And when you conclude that there is a definite connection, there we go. Are we on the screen?
Broken.
Well, don't worry about it. I'll figure it out. And that's when the sky becomes the limit. Because when you connect what you think about with your results, you think, well, hey, if I imagine something small and that happened, what would happen if I imagine something really impossible? So let's do it again. Let's take another mental snapshot of the can. The hole in the top, the indention in the bottom, and the now cylindrical shape one more time. And I want us to try and envision the can just as it was when it came out of the refrigerator. Imagine the top of a Coke can, perfectly sealed. Let me ask you a question, sir. Is that Coke can sealed?
Absolutely.
It is. And you can even feel the Coke that came out of it just a moment ago, can't you? Yeah. And it's still room temperature, too, but now that's going to change because we're going to take it up yet another notch. We are going to now try to fill this empty, sealed Coke can with ice-cold Coca-Cola. Sir, I just want you to listen. Did you hear something? What did you hear? Air? That was actually the sound of ice-cold Coca-Cola being injected into the can directly from the netherworld. Listen. Did you hear that? Tell us what you heard. Sizzle. Please hold on. Just listen to this. Did you hear something? Would you do me a favor? Would you touch the can? Is it getting cooler?
Yes.
Just listen. Did you hear anything? Hold your hand out. Would you say this can is maybe a third full now? And what temperature is it? It's cold. We're going to make it colder and fuller. Just listen. Did you hear that? Yes, you heard it squirt in there, didn't you? Listen. Is that half full now? Let's put some more in here. Just listen. Did you hear anything? Hold your hand out. Would you say that's maybe two-thirds full now? Ice cold now? Let's fill it all the way to the top. Can you hear anything in there? You now hear sloshing. I never have to buy Coke. Most of you seem excited, but I'll bet there are some of you in here that are dreading this upcoming school year. In fact, because I'm a magician, I can have visions. In fact, I see some of you sitting at your kitchen table just 2 or 3 weeks ago with a legal pad, a pen, and a calculator. I'm zooming in. You're trying to figure out if you can get by on your spouse's income alone. Because some of you feel today like that Coke can was, empty and crushed. I'm going to try and restore you the same way I did the Coke can. My goal is that you will leave here full, pumped up, and brand new. If you're going to do that, you have to be committed to doing whatever it takes to make a difference in the lives of the kids. You have to get on the ball in four areas. The story goes that the mayor of a large city was being driven back to work after a luncheon speech when the limo pulled up to a traffic light and came to a stop. It's perfect. We're good. The mayor glanced out the window and saw two city employees hard at work. One of them dug a hole, the other came right behind him and filled it in. The mayor thought this was odd, but before he could say anything, the light changed and the limo pulled away. Yet as they traveled, the mayor could see on both sides of the boulevard, every 50 feet for the next 2 miles was an identical filled-in hole. By the time he got back to City Hall, the mayor was livid at this obvious waste of the taxpayers' money. So he dispatched an aide to find out what was going on. 2 hours later, the aide returned and said, "Mayor, it's nothing to worry about." Turns out, usually, that's a three-man crew. But the third guy's on vacation this week, and he's the one that plants the trees. There are very few in life so sad as going through the motions of doing your job with no higher goal in mind. And yet that is what hundreds of millions of people do every single day of their working lives. They go off to their workplace and they check off all of the demands required of their job description and then go home with no higher goal in mind than just growing old and paying the bills. But you dare not and you need not allow that to happen to you. I hope that you figured out by now that when you work in education, you don't have the luxury or the drudgery of going to work as cavalierly as an accountant at Microsoft or an engineer at Motorola or a busboy at Applebee's might. This cannot be just a job for you. It's too important for that. This should not even be merely a career for you. It's too critical even for that. This is a calling. This is a life mission. This is a noble cause. This should become for you a magnificent obsession, one that is utterly worthy of the investment of this, your one and only life. You should come to work every day with all of the zeal of a Baptist evangelist saving souls, or Mother Teresa going to the ghetto of Calcutta to rescue the orphans and the lepers, or all of the urgency of a lifeguard paddling out to save a drowning swimmer. This is a noble cause, one that is utterly worthy of the investment of this, your one and only life. And what is that cause? It is to bequeath to the next generation the greatest gift anybody can ever receive. and that is a fantastic education and all of the benefits that will flow from it. A vision that is driven by the knowledge that if you can just bump the trajectory of a kid's life off by 5 or 10 degrees, that slight change in direction will, over the course of 5 to 7 decades, widen into a gap of 1,000 miles. Let me ask you a question. Why do you come to work in the morning? I hope it's not for a paycheck. Let me tell you something. To work for a paycheck in any profession, but especially in education, is to unnecessarily doom yourself to a life of emptiness and mediocrity. Highly effective people who enjoy their jobs and their careers tremendously are people who do not work for a mere paycheck. They work for the fulfillment of what I call a magical dream. And the paycheck is just what they use to cover their bills during the journey. So why do you come to work? I think it was a good thing during the first decade of this new century, while my son was wending his way through elementary school, that I was not home much during the month of August. As you can imagine, I spend this season every year crisscrossing the country doing opening convocations and in-services like this one, and I was quite content to be away from my otherwise pleasant home during the month of August because, at that time, it was not a pleasant place to be. My wife was a nervous wreck. Her anxiety level would begin to rise in the middle of June, and it would reach its crescendo on a Thursday afternoon in the middle of August, circled in red on her calendar at precisely 4 p.m. Because it was on that day, at that time, that our son's elementary school would post his teacher assignment for the upcoming school year. And all summer long, we had been hoping against hope that our little boy would get assigned to one particular teacher or one of two particular teachers in each grade, because those teachers' reputations had preceded them. Every year, somehow, they managed to take every student and brush away the ashes, find a few glowing embers, and begin to slowly blow on them until they erupt into an inferno of a desire for learning. But just to be candid, which I can because I'm leaving in a couple of hours, all summer long, we found ourselves praying that our boy would not get stuck with one particular teacher in each grade. Even the atheists in our neighborhood go to church all summer long just to hedge their bets. Because those teachers' reputations had preceded them as well. Somehow every year they managed to take every student, brush away the ashes, find a few glowing embers, and pour water all over them. Now, what is the difference between those two teachers? Sir, I'm sorry, but I'm going to have to ask you to leave. And don't come back till you're finished. What is the difference between those two teachers? Well, I'm sure there are many, but at the core, it is, I suspect, why that teacher goes to work in the morning. That teacher that you want your kid or your grandkid or your nephew or your niece being taught by, let me tell you why he or she goes to work in the morning. They love kids. And they believe at the core of their soul, with every fiber of their being, that they are making a profound and a lasting difference in the life of every kid that sits in front of them.
Now that teacher, you don't want your kid being taught by, let me tell you why he or she goes to work in the morning. They need health insurance.
Or a pension plan. Or they've got 3 years till retirement and they are hanging on for dear life. Is there a fire burning in your belly to transform the lives of the kids? Does it burn so brightly that it keeps you awake nights? And when you finally fall asleep, do you find yourself dreaming about it? And when you wake up in the morning, is it one of the first thoughts on your mind? And as you go through your workday, do you find yourself scheming and dreaming about ways to do it better, to reach more kids, to reach different kids, to reach the same kids at a deeper level? If you don't have that type of a passion and you can't get it, you will never be as effective as you could otherwise be, and you will not enjoy your career anywhere near as much as you otherwise could, just by choosing to get on the ball with regard to the right motives. Come because of the kids. Never forget why you do what you do. Now, because I'm magic, I can read your minds. There are 43 people in the room right now thinking, Mr. Fancy Pants, motivational speaker, not all of us are teachers. I know that. And it does not change my point one whit. Regardless of your job description, you have to come to work each and every day because you believe in the dream. Because you are a part of the organization and the team that makes it all possible. There was once a monk who was overseeing a church building project. He went out to the construction site to see how progress was coming and saw four men chipping stones. He asked the first, "My son, what are you doing?" The man scowled. He said, "Father, I'm chipping stones." He turned to the second. He said, "My son, what are you doing?" The man matter-of-factly said, "Father, I'm building a wall." He walked over to the third. He said, "My son, what are you doing?" The man smiled. He said, "Father, I'm constructing a cathedral." He approached the fourth. He said, "My son, what are you doing?" The man's face lit up. He positively beamed as he said, "Father, I'm advancing the kingdom of God on earth, one stone at a time." Here are four men doing exactly the same job, but with a totally different passion level, probably a different quality level, and absolutely a different job satisfaction level. I believe that it is your solemn duty as an employee of the school system to ruthlessly discipline yourself every day that you come to work to give that fourth level of an answer. I wonder if 6 months from now I was to walk up to one of you teachers in disguise and say, "What are you doing?" How would you reply? "I'm making out one more corollary reading list for the students to completely ignore." Or would you say, "I'm making sure the kids in my class one day go to college instead of jail. That they live in houses instead of under bridges. That they drive reliable cars instead of death traps. That they have careers instead of jobs. That they never once as an adult have to ask anybody if they want fries with that. That they become contributing, tax-paying members of society instead of drains upon it. Come to think of it, I'm probably making sure that their kids and their grandkids and their great-grandkids follow suit. I'm making sure that they grow up with pride and self-esteem instead of shame their whole lives. I'm transforming the world one ignored homework assignment at a time." About 9 years ago, I was invited to be the opening convocation speaker on the campus of Orange County Community College in Los Angeles, California. At the end of the program, I was on stage packing up to go back to the airport when an elderly woman made her way on stage and introduced herself. We'll call her Mrs. Smith. She explained how for almost 35 years she had taught math at the high school level in the public schools of LA before retiring and becoming a part-time professor at the college. She said, "Way back in about 1970, there was a junior in my math class named David." She said, "David sat in the back of the room, and he had long hair in a time when that was considered a sign of rebellion. He wore an earring in an era when that was completely unheard of among males. He was sullen, somber, quiet, didn't participate much, and he wasn't doing very well in school." She said, "One day I got a call from David's dad. And he said, 'Mrs. Smith, can you please do something for our boy David? He's got a good heart and a good mind, but unless somebody intervenes, that boy is never going to graduate from high school. He won't listen to us. He hates us. Can you please try to help our David?'" She said, "I'll see what I can do." So she said one day she pulled David aside and said, "David, do you prefer working with your hands or with people more?" He said, "With my hands." She said, "I've got a little garden in my backyard, and if you'd like to make some extra money, I'll pay you to come over to my house and work in my garden after school." And so she said for the next couple of years, every now and then after school, David would come over to her house and work in her garden, and she would either work alongside him or just follow him around in a lawn chair and listen to the boy rant about how much he hated life and how much he hated school and how much he hated his parents, especially his dad. She said, to make a long story short, eventually David cobbled together all the credits he needed to graduate on time with the rest of his class. She said, "I'll never forget how at the graduation ceremony, David's dad came up and gave me a bear hug and said, 'Mrs. Smith, thank you from the bottom of our hearts. If it weren't for you, David never would have earned his high school diploma.'" She said, "For more than 30 years, I treasured that moment in my heart as one of those little perks that we educators get way too seldom in this job." But then she said, "Now let me tell you the epilogue." She said, "Not long ago, I got another call from David's dad, who is now an elderly man. And he said, 'Mrs. Smith, you may not remember us, but we've never forgotten you. More than 3 decades ago, you helped our son David graduate from high school, and he's always been grateful to you for the investment that you made in his life. He said, David turns 50 very soon, and he specifically asked us to see if we could find you and persuade you to come to his birthday party so that he can honor you there. And she said she was completely flummoxed and flabbergasted and taken aback. And she said, well, of course I remember David. I would love to come to his birthday party. Whatever became of David? And the dad said, you don't know? He works at USC Hospital as the chief of surgery. Wow. Now, here is a boy who, on the one hand, never would have graduated from high school but for one woman's love, who now, because of the investment of a little bit of her time and a little bit of her money and a whole lot of her heart, is the chief of surgery at one of the biggest hospitals in one of the biggest cities on earth. And then Mrs. Smith said, do you know what really gets me? I said, what? She said, if I had never gotten that second phone call, I would have gone to my grave, never having any idea the difference I made in David's life. Listen carefully. Most of you will never get that second phone call. A lot of you, because of your job description, will never even get the first phone call. But you must never allow yourself to doubt for a moment that there are many Davids out there. And there are more to be made this academic year in Eagle Pass. And that's why you go to work in the morning. Let me say this as sweetly and gently as I possibly can. You dare not do a job this important for a paltry paycheck. It's too important for that. Do it because you believe in the dream. Now, I know that you're a professional. You worked hard for your degree. You work hard for your paycheck. By all means, cash it. Pay your bills. Put aside a little for retirement. Take a nice vacation every now and then. You've earned it. You deserve it. But don't do it for that. Do it to make more Davids. And one of the most wonderful little serendipities of life is this. The men and women in this room who go to work each and every day, not for a paycheck, but to make more Davids, will almost certainly be the people 5 to 10 years from now getting the bigger paychecks anyway. And having enjoyed the ride 100-fold more than those poor, pitiful souls who have unnecessarily sentenced themselves to a life of emptiness, devoid of meaning, by simply choosing to work for a few paltry scraps of cash. Do you have any idea how many hundreds of millions of people in this world have to volunteer their time after work or on weekends to gain just a fraction of the personal fulfillment that you can enjoy by working full-time and getting paid for it? If you ever get your head fully wrapped around that concept, there will be times when you wake up in the middle of the night with tingles running up and down your spine in wonder and amazement that they will actually pay you to participate in a cause so noble. Let's try an experiment. I'm going to place up here on the screen a list of the things that people crave most in life. I would like you to please mentally select any single word or term as it passes by and commit it to memory. In particular, I want you to make sure that you know how your word is spelled. Everybody have one? Here they are all at once. You have 4 seconds to choose yours and commit it to memory. Do you know how it's spelled? Good, because now they're gone. Here are the first 5 letters of the alphabet. In a moment, I'm going to ask you in your imagination to place your finger on one of these boxes and then to move it a particular number of boxes to be chosen at random by members of the audience. For example, if you choose to place your finger on box A and somebody in the audience says 4, you can move your finger B, C, D, E, that's 4, or should you choose to start on box A and someone in the audience say 4, you could move your finger B, C, D, C, that's also 4. Your other alternative, and your only other alternative, would be to move B, A, B, A, and end up right back where you started, as long as you always move to an adjacent box. You can't skip around. When your finger's on an outside box, you're forced to turn around and move back toward the middle. But when your finger's on an inside box, you can go either way. Fair enough? Excellent. Okay, in your imagination, I'd like you to place your finger squarely on any letter that you see up here, which is contained in the word that you just thought of. No cheating. It has to be contained in the word you thought of from that long list to mathematically guarantee that our fingers will be roughly spread out evenly among all 5 boxes. If your word contains only one of these letters, you have no choice. If it contains 2 or 3, take your pick. Everybody got your finger on a box? Leave it right where it is and don't move it as I change the labels, to represent the five things that are rumored to be essential to getting ahead in life. Ma'am, would you please name a number 1 to 5 other than 4? I don't want to set you up for that. What? Move your finger 2 boxes very carefully. Leave it right where it is. We're going to mix it up a bit more. Name a number 1 to 5, please.
3.
Move your finger 3 more boxes. Now, these people could have chosen any numbers at all, and your finger would be somewhere else entirely, and yet I am so magic that I sense that there's not a person in the room with your finger on luck. The people in this life who get ahead do not do so by luck. They do so by creating their own luck through hard work and persistence. We'll remove it. Please name a number 1 to 5.
5.
Move your finger 5 boxes very carefully and check your work. Now, she could have said 1, 2, 3, or 4, and your finger would be somewhere else completely, and yet I am so incredibly magic that I sense that your finger is not on IQ. There is a very shaky relationship between your intelligence on the one hand and your happiness and success on the other. In fact, a really high IQ is actually a counterindicator of success. That will be your secretary reminding you to turn off your phone. We will eliminate it. Ma'am, please name a number 1 to 3.
2.
Move your finger 2 boxes. Let's mix it up even further. Name a different number 1 to 3. Move your finger 3 more boxes. Now, they could have chosen different numbers, and your finger would be somewhere else, and yet somehow, I know, because I am so freaking magic, that your finger is not on looks. Good looks are not an indicator of success or happiness, nor is your finger on talent. Unrewarded talent is everywhere. Unrewarded talent is more common than rewarded talent. We will eliminate it because you have placed your finger squarely and literally on the single most consistent predictor of success and happiness in life, your attitude. So you're going to have to get on the ball with regard to the right attitude. Now, when I was about 6 years old, one day I innocently left several unwrapped Hershey Kisses on the dashboard of my mother's car on a hot summer day. We came back an hour or two later to find they had melted all down the dashboard and into the carpet. I have a question for you. What was it about my mother's car that made the chocolate melt? Heat? Wrong answer. We have some nice party gifts for you. It's a lifetime supply of Lee Press-On Nails. Tell us about them, Johnny. It's not the heat, I'm going to prove it to you. Let's suppose that instead of heating some lumps of chocolate to 140 degrees for 2 hours, we instead took some lumps of clay, put them in a kiln, and heated them to 2,000 degrees for 12 hours. What would happen to them? They would harden. Don't ever allow yourself to believe that it is the heat applied to you by your students, or by their parents, or by your boss, or by your workload, or by government regulations and paperwork. Heat cannot do that. The only thing heat can do is reveal the stuff of which you are made. And that's great news. Do you know why? Because unlike the lumps of chocolate and the lumps of clay, you and I as human beings have the high privilege and the incontrovertible right of choosing the stuff of which we are made. We do that every single day of our lives by exercising our right as human beings to choose our attitude. And despite the fact that you've heard your whole life how important it is that you maintain a PMA, some of you still awaken this morning with your brain groping for any excuse to be negative. What's yours? Is money a little tight around your place? Have you been through a nasty breakup? Do you find certain parts of your job unpleasant? Are you too tired to go on? You're having a feud with your neighbors? Are you overloaded today? Do you see troubling signs your kid will grow up to be a rapper?
Maybe you just hate your name. Are you annoyed by life's little inconveniences? Do you worry the kids are not paying attention in class? Are some of your coworkers just plain lazy? Is your past catching up with you? Do other people not treat you with respect? Well, regardless of the excuse you gave yourself for getting up on the wrong side of the bed this morning, I know what the problem was. You woke up with your head in the wrong place. It's my job to help you get your head in the right place. Let me tell you what I believe may be the most important question you ever answer in your life is. It is this: is the glass half full or half empty? And here's the answer. It's up to you. To me, that is the most wonderful fact of this life, that no one on this planet but you can answer this question for you. And the way that you choose to answer it each and every day when you get out of bed will determine more than any other factor in life how happy you become, and more than most, how successful you become. It's the great equalizer of life. It would be horribly unfair if the factor that determined your satisfaction level in life was your ability to think like Albert Einstein, or jump like Michael Jordan, or sing like Madonna. What happens if you come into the world jumping like Albert Einstein, singing like Michael Jordan, thinking like Madonna? Would you be doomed to a miserable life? No, because you would still get to answer this question for you, but listen carefully. It is the eternal law of life that if you choose to get up every day with your head in the wrong place and say, my glass is half empty, it will get emptier. The consequence of a negative attitude is that you will attract bad things and bad people to yourself, and over the course of your lifetime, you will drain your glass to the dregs of all of the joy that you otherwise could have known, and you'll find a very troubling process at work in your soul. Not only will your glass grow emptier, it will also grow smaller. Your ability to know joy will slowly diminish as year by year and decade by decade you find yourself paying the compounded interest on a life lived with a sour, negative outlook. But the converse is also true. If you choose to get up every day with your head in the right place and say, my glass is half full, it will get fuller. By virtue of a fabulous attitude, you'll attract good things and good people to yourself and fill your glass to overflowing with all of the joy that life can contain. And you'll find a wonderful process at work in your life. Your glass will grow larger. Okay, last time, this is your brain. But they don't have that commercial in Eagle Pass. This is your brain on a bad attitude. And this is your brain on a good one. But a word of warning. Let one negative thought creep into your mind and find a home there, and the process will begin all over again. Let it find fertile soil and send deep roots into your psyche, and your glass will drain once more. Every time the bitterness starts to fade away, be sure to nurse your grudge and fan it back into flame so you can be bitter and brood a little longer. There's only one thing you can do to make your glass stop draining. It's to get your head in the right place and say, my glass is half full. So you're left with life's most important question. Is the glass half full or half empty? And the answer is up to you. Thank you. People are always asking me how I got started as a magician. I will never forget that momentous day when the host of my favorite TV show literally set the course
set the course for my life by teaching the viewers a simple magic trick. What I'd like to do is reenact that day for you so that you can enjoy it along with me. In order to do this, I need to borrow something from the audience, not a person, so don't get nervous. I actually need to borrow a woman's purse. Ma'am, can you think of anybody in this entire auditorium who might be willing to allow me to borrow her purse? Anyone. Anyone at all. Would you mind unzipping it so I can see inside? You know, most restaurants will wrap that potato salad. I need something that opens further. That's what I need. Can I borrow your purse?
It's not a purse.
What is it?
A briefcase?
That's okay. It's God's will. Can I borrow it?
Okay.
Where are you from? Everybody pass your wallets and jewelry this way. Trust me, I'm a magician. Is it okay if they see the inside of it? The host of my favorite TV show said we were to get our mom's favorite handbag with which he would teach us to do a simple magic trick. This portfolio will represent my mother's favorite purse when I was just a little boy. Several years ago, I wrote to the network and I told them how that show had changed my life. They were nice enough to send me a copy of it. I don't have a video, so use your imagination as you hear the audio track only of the show that changed my life as a little boy. It's a beautiful day in this neighborhood, a beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? It's a neighborly day in this neighborhood, a neighborly day for a beauty. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? I have always wanted to have a neighbor just like me. I've always wanted to live in the neighborhood with you. So let's make the most of this beautiful day. Since we're together, we might as well say, won't you be mine? Won't you be mine? Won't you be my neighbor? Won't you please? Won't you please? Please won't you be my neighbor? Today, we're going to learn a magic trick. We're going to make a bandana disappear. Can you say bandana?
Bandana.
Shit, I need you good. First, you need to take out a bandana. Now, fold the bandana in half. That's right. Fold it in half. Fold it one more time. Now, secretly take the folded bandana and hide it in your left hand. Be sure to keep your hand in a natural position. This is known as palming. Now that you've perfected palming, we're ready to begin. Open up the folded bandana. Greet the audience by waving it up and down. To prove that it's a real bandana, let a member of the audience wipe his face with it. Or you can let someone blow his nose in it. Now, take out your mother's favorite handbag. Place the bandana in the handbag. Now, close the handbag firmly around the bandana. What the audience doesn't know, neighbor, is that you never put the bandana in the handbag at all. That's right.
You kept it hidden in your left hand. Remember calling? Sure, I knew you would. Remember to keep your hand in a natural position. Now, make a magical gesture under the handbag. And with a grand flourish, fling the handbag open and wait for your well-deserved response.
Now, some of you are wondering how I did that. All of you are wondering why I did that. It's an object lesson to illustrate a very important point, and that is that you and I have something in common. We all became illusionists as small children. In fact, psychologists tell us that the faulty perceptions of the world that we all drag with us through adult life to cripple our creativity, paralyze our potential, limit our sales, impede our progress, drain our lives of joy, and impede our ability to make a difference in the lives of the students were usually formed in our minds by about the age of 6. The difference between my illusions and yours is that I perform mine to fool you. But the illusions we all carry with us in our heads are defense mechanisms designed by the psyche to deceive no one but ourselves. Let me tell you what I believe is the grandest illusion swirling around in the minds of teachers all over the world. One that infects the minds of untold millions of teachers worldwide. And if you buy into it even a little bit, it will diminish your ability to make an impact on your students' lives. Here is grand illusion number one of the teaching profession. I have done my job once I have stood in front of my classroom and said the words I was supposed to say. Or, phrased another way, I have done my job once I have covered all of the material in the textbook and or the curriculum. Or, phrased yet another way, I have done my job once the contents of my notes have been more or less accurately reproduced in the notes of my students. Or phrased still another way, I have done my job if, at the end of the school year, I am still alive. In my right mind, and welcome to return next fall. Or, and please indulge me as I dare to paraphrase one final time, this time from the viewpoint of the pupil, the student has learned if his or her body was physically in the room during the lesson. That is an illusion. Because there is a huge difference between a teacher and a lecturer. You can give a lecture in an empty classroom, and a darn fine one, but you can't teach in one. You can give a lecture to students who are staring out the window, doodling furiously on their notebooks, or sleeping on their desks in a puddle of drool. But you can't teach students who are not paying attention. This is because teach is a transitive verb. Now, for those of you who are not among my fellow grammar Nazis, let me help you understand the difference between a transitive and an intransitive verb. An intransitive verb is one that does not need an object, like bark. The dog barked. That makes perfect sense. A transitive verb, on the other hand, needs an object or two in order for it to make sense, like through, T-H-R-E-W. The boy through doesn't make any sense at all until you add an object or two. The boy threw the ball to his father. Teach, in its highest form, is that latter type of verb. It has little meaning when divorced from the impact that it has on something or someone else. What this means is that you have not taught somebody simply because their body was in the room. You have not taught somebody geometry just because they were physically there while you were talking about geometry. You have only taught someone geometry when they can do a proof. I taught my son how to play chess a while back. You say, can he play? No, he's horrible. He can't even remember which way the pieces move and couldn't care less. I taught him. He just didn't learn. I'm a great teacher. He's just a sucky pupil. You see how ridiculous that is? I have not taught my son to play chess until he can play with some degree of competency. What this means is that you have to have the right focus. Everything that goes on in this district must be about the students. It's not about facilities. It's not about unions. It's not about budgets. It's not about the teacher's convenience. It's not about school nutrition or transportation or logistics. It's all about the kids. Everything that takes place must be evaluated through one lens. How does it impact the students? So,
How are you going to do that? You are going to try and have a student-centered environment. I would love to do these opening convocations in student-centered venues, but I never can. There are too many of you. It's impractical. This is not a student-centered venue. This is a performer-centered venue, isn't it? All the chairs are bolted to the floor facing this way because in a room like this, the important stuff takes place up here. But in a classroom, it's the exact opposite. The important stuff takes place out here. That's why I asked them to turn the lights up, because I want to be able to see your eyeballs. You know what I hate? And it's happened 4 or 5 times over the last 3 weeks alone. I show up at 6:30 in the morning to set up for an opening convocation. I walk into the auditorium, and there's a stage that's 5 feet tall. Then there's an orchestra pit in front of that. And then there are 8 or 10 feet of empty space between that. And then the front row of chairs is there. And then the front 8 rows are empty. And so the first person I'm talking to is 40 feet away. And so what I end up doing almost every time is I speak in front of the orchestra pit. I speak down here. And at the end of it, people say, well, you know, if you'd stand up on the stage, we can see you better. I know that. But if I stand down here, I can see you better. That's the important thing, because this is not about me. It's about you. I'm not a Vegas entertainer today. I'm a teacher with 1,000 students, with all with different learning styles, all with different interest levels and energy levels. And if I'm down here on the floor, I can see your eyeballs. And the entire time I'm on the platform, I'm reading eyes. I want to know who's with me and who's not. I'm fighting for the attention of every pair of eyeballs in the room at every single second. About 10 years ago, I did a program like this on the campus of in Sheldon ISD outside of Houston. There were 700 teachers in a long, skinny cafetorium. So the back row was about as far as the back row is here, but a much smaller crowd, and it had a center aisle. And at the end of it, they all filled out evaluation cards, and 11 of the teachers criticized me for something that I did 3 times that really bugged them. In the middle of my presentation, 3 times, I walked off the platform. I walked past half of the audience, and I slipped into here, and I spoke from here. There was a little more room, sorry. Now, why in the world would I do that, making these people crane their necks to see what I'm doing? Well, it's because halfway, because all the way from stage, I could see halfway back down the center aisle, 1 seat removed from that center aisle, there was a guy sitting right here that was trying to go to sleep. And so I walked all the way down there past half the audience, went kneecap to kneecap with that guy, and I spoke from there. And after about 10 seconds, the dozing man thought, that's really loud. And he looked up, and I was staring straight at him. I gave the next 10 seconds of the lesson directly to him, kneecap to kneecap, eyeball to eyeball, turned around, went back on the stage, and he had the gall to do it again. 3 times in front of 700 people, I had to walk halfway past half of them, kneecap to kneecap, eyeball to eyeball, until he figured out he wasn't getting any sleep in my class. Now, it may not be my fault that that guy was going to sleep. He might have been up all night with a crying baby. How do I know? But it's my responsibility. You see, I can do a great magic show or give a great lecture whether that guy was paying attention or not, right? But it's not about me. It's evaluated by how he's going to be different when the students hit the campus, right? And so I had to keep him. Now, let's suppose that let me move over here to get away from the speakers. Let's suppose that as I was speaking, this nice gentleman was to have his mind wander. Raise your hand if your mind has ever wandered during a speech. If your neighbor's hand isn't up, their mind is wandering now. I'll make a confession. Sometimes my mind wanders during my own speech. Hey, if sometimes my mind wanders while I'm speaking, I can hardly blame you if it happens every now and then. It may not be my fault, but it's my responsibility. So if he were to get this faraway look in his eyes, just a glazed over, he's staring off into space. If it's about me, no problem. I can do some pretty amazing magic tricks whether he's paying attention or not. I can give a great lecture whether he's paying attention or not, but I'm not going to change his life. So if I see that he is gazing off into space, all I do is I just walk by him, I make a big gesture through his line of sight, and I've got him back. Or I stop and I crack a joke, and as soon as everybody else laughs, he comes to, turns to his neighbor and says, what did I miss? Or I just walk by and accidentally bump his foot or his shoulder as I walk by.
because I've got to get him back. It's all about you. The focus is always on the students. It's magic. That's the sound of magic flowing from me. See, these ladies here, they thought it was body odor. It's not. It's magic. They smell similar. What I'm saying is that a master teacher joyfully takes upon his shoulders or her shoulders the responsibility for the student's learning. A great teacher will never allow herself the luxury of evaluating her performance based on what she has done. Rather, she evaluates her performance based solely on one criterion, and that is what happens in the student as a result of what the teacher has done. A great teacher will never pat himself on the back for delivering this year's lesson more eloquently than last year's, unless, of course, that improved eloquence translates into greater learning and life change in the student. Make it all about the students. Be sure that you have the right focus. That's magic. What you just saw is a table moved by an invisible force, a completely natural force, I assure you. But your life in a similar fashion is moved by a host of invisible forces, your beliefs, your assumptions, your biases, your defense mechanisms. But there's a curious one that is unique only to human beings, and that is that we are moved by the expectations of others. Did you know that the students can read your mind? They know what you think about them. I don't care how hard you try to hide it behind plastic smiles, insincere compliments, phony words, and overly generous grades. They know what you think about them, and it is the uniquely human tendency for them to try to live up to or down to your expectations, which is why you're going to have to get on the ball with regard to the right expectations. There was a fascinating study run in San Francisco, California in 1963. A Harvard psychologist by the name of Dr. Robert Rosenthal decided to try an experiment in the power of expectations. He selected one elementary school in South Central San Francisco because of a prior relationship with the principal there. On day one of classes in the autumn of 1963, he gave every student at Oak Elementary School a standard IQ test, tabulated the results, and deliberately misled their teachers. He told the teachers he had actually administered the Harvard test of inflected acquisition, a completely bogus name for a test that did not exist, but which, he told the teachers, had been developed at Harvard for the purpose of predicting which students were about to blossom, come into their own, have their best year ever. He then randomly selected the names of several students, gave them back to the teachers, and said, according to our test results, we think these students will blossom this year. So 20% of the students had been picked as ready to blossom, randomly, 80% not. And he told the teachers, it is absolutely crucial that you don't communicate your heightened expectations of the student to him or her in any way, verbally or non-verbally. That obviously would skew the results and invalidate the test. I don't even have to finish the story, do I? You know what happened, don't you? At the end of the school year, he came back and gave every student at Oak Elementary School the very same IQ test they had taken 9 months earlier. Listen carefully. Among the 80% of students whose names had not been randomly picked as ready to blossom, their IQ score did exactly what it was supposed to do, little or no change. But among the handful of students, the 20%ers whose names had been picked out of a hat as ready to blossom, their IQ score had risen on average by 13 points. A few students in the first and second grade saw their IQ score shoot up 30 points in one academic year. Folks, a 30-point IQ swing is a neuroscientific earthquake.
The difference between an 85 IQ and a 115 IQ represents the gap between a waitress and ready for med school. IQ is never supposed to change. It's supposed to remain static from the cradle into old age. What happened? Well, you know what happened. Something in the teacher's eyes communicated, I believe in you. Every time the teacher came down to little Susie or little Jimmy to ask her a question or him a question, she'd wait 5 seconds longer as if to say, I know you can do this. And those children came out of their seats with motivation as never before in their lives because one person believed in them. Now, I don't know if their IQ actually went up. I'm not even sure that's possible. I kind of think it's hardwired into the central nervous system at conception. But even if their actual IQ didn't go up, their I try did. And that's the point. Their I believe in myself went through the roof. Their I'll do my absolute best skyrocketed because one teacher believed in them. Dr. Rosenthal put spies in the classrooms throughout that academic year to see if they could detect any subtle changes in the way the teachers treated the 20%ers as opposed to the 80%ers. And they observed 4 differences. First of all, they said the teacher looked at the 20%ers with greater love, warmth, and affection, which communicated to the child, you're special. And like magic, those children began to think of themselves as special. I've been the scoutmaster of my son's Boy Scout troop in Austin for the last 3 years. I've got 65 boys in my troop, and I want every single one of them to believe he's my favorite. When I look them in the eyes, I want them to see love, compassion, high expectations, and belief. I'm pulling them off to the side constantly and saying, don't tell anyone else I said this, but you could be one of the greatest leaders this troop ever produced. Secondly, Dr. Rosenthal said the teacher called on the 20%ers more often. He gave them more opportunities to participate, which told the child, you're one of my best students. And abracadabra, they were. Thirdly, she gave them more assignments and harder assignments than everyone else because she lived under the illusion that these children were better prepared to do the difficult work than all of the others. And voila, suddenly they were. Finally, she gave them different feedback. When a 20%er turned in good work, she would be effusive with her praise. She'd say, you see, I knew you could do it. I told you you could do it. Great job. But when they did bad work, she'd throw it right back in their faces. She'd say, this is unacceptable. You are smart. You can do better. And presto chango, they could. And they did. But when an 80%er turned in bad work, she wouldn't say anything. She'd just look at them with a disappointed expression and shake her head, as if to throw up her hands, shrug her shoulders, and say, well, what else should I expect? You weren't ready to blossom anyway. And double toil and trouble. Fire burn and cauldron bubble. Dark magic flew out of that teacher's eyes and enveloped that poor child in a shroud of negativity. And mumbo jumbo, they weren't, in fact, ready to blossom, and therefore they didn't. I want you to do me a favor. I want you to think back to the adult in your life, other than your mom or dad, who had the greatest positive influence on you as you were growing up. Your Mrs. Smith from the earlier story about David. Can you picture that man or woman? Let's try an exercise. I want you in 1 or 2 words to answer back to me the quality that most stands out in your mind about that person. Just raise your hands and I'll call on you. What was that man or woman like? What quality stands out in your mind about the person that really made the difference for you, like Mrs. Smith did for David? Who'll start us off?
Compassion.
Compassion, but you didn't raise your hand. You're going to have to leave. Yes, down here?
Caring.
Caring. Yes. Enthusiasm. Lovable. Love, yeah.
A good listener.
I'm sorry, I wasn't listening. I'm just kidding. Good listener, she said. Yes, ma'am. And that's a whole lot more than 2 words. Don't mess with me, I'm magic. I could strangle you with a cordless phone. So she made everybody feel special. What else?
Patient.
Positive. Okay, we could go on another 5 minutes this way. I don't want to use everybody's time this way because the things that you said back to me are not the interesting thing. The fascinating thing to me is the things that nobody ever says in response to that question. I made a prediction 25 years ago, because I'm magic and all, of words that would never be said back to me in response to that question. I've taken about 300,000 educators through that exercise over the last quarter of a century, and out of a very long list of descriptors, I've been wrong 6 times. Let me first of all share with you the words nobody has ever said in response to that question. Nobody has ever raised his hand and said, that guy was sharp. You should have seen the crease in that man's pants. Coiffed, pressed, dapper, manicured, sharp guy. No one's ever said, she was brilliant. Or rich, influential, powerful, eloquent, celebrity, tall, gorgeous, superstar, published, famous, highly educated, erudite, certified, athletic, successful, fascinating, good-looking, well-heeled, scholarly, high-class, articulate, handsome, beautiful, sexy, buff. Not one person out of 300,000 has listed one of those words. Now, by way of full disclosure, there were 4 words on the original list that have been said back to me once or twice each. They are smart, dynamic, charismatic, and talented. Do you know what this little exercise tells me? It tells me that the qualities we place a premium on in our society for describing somebody who really makes a difference in the life of other people really have very little to do with the matter. Think back to that list of things you just said back to me. Is there any one of those that you cannot do or be? Can you be caring? Can you be loving? Can you be patient? Can you be compassionate? Can you be positive? Anybody can do these things, which is the great equalizer among educators everywhere. You don't have to have an IQ of 160. To make a real difference. The guy that made the difference in my life was a man named Mike Henderson. It was 25 years before I could talk about him without choking up. Do you know why? Because here's a guy who didn't have to love me. He would have rather been home with his wife and kids, I'm sure, but he took time to invest in me. So let me give you a twofold challenge as we start this school year. Love your students. I'm the kind of guy that wanted 6 or 8 kids. I adore children. Didn't work out that way. My first wife was infertile. My second wife was almost 40 by the time we married. I feel fortunate to have gotten 1 biological child out of this life. And when he was about 3 or 4 or 5 or so, and I'm taking him, and I'm putting him in kindergarten at around 5, I'm putting him in first grade, and I'm giving him to you for 6 or 7 or 8 hours a day, more time than I will ever spend with that boy in his entire life. That is a high and a sacred trust. You better love my boy. But more importantly, and more specifically, pick out 1 or 2 or 3 that you will be there, Mrs. Smith. You will be there, Mike Henderson. You will be the person that 30 years from now, they are choking back tears about as they discuss the difference that you made in their life. Now, because I'm magic, I can read your minds. 43 people in the room saying, catch a clue, we're not all teachers. I know that, and it matters not one whit. You don't have to be a teacher to do this. Mrs. Smith didn't change David's life from a teacher's desk in a classroom. She changed it from a lawn chair in her backyard. And I'll bet you have a lawn chair. And if you don't, they're cheap. You can do this from the front office. How many front office workers do we have at school? Any office workers out here? Yeah, scattered around. What do your eyes say to a kid that's been sent to the principal for the 3rd time in a week? Don't expect me to visit you in prison, kid. What do your principal say, or what do your eyes say to some kid that's been a little bit of trouble? You better not act up today, boy. And your eyes say, okay, you've got a lot of misplaced energy right now, but one day that will be channeled into a truly great man or woman. So get on the ball with regard to the right motives. Don't do this job for a paycheck. You're short-circuiting the kids and you're short-changing yourself when you do. Come to work every day. Get on the ball with the right attitude. Be positive and upbeat, because your classroom or your campus will for some of them be an oasis of positivity and tranquility in a personal life that is a desert of chaos and tumult and negativity. Come every day with the right focus. Evaluate what you do through the lens of how it impacts the students. And fourth, come to work with the right expectations. Get on the ball with regard to expectations. One last story. The world's worst golfer went out on the first day of spring and teed up the first softball of the season. Now, he was not about to take a penalty stroke on the first day of the swing of the season, but he did indeed slice that ball way off into the woods on the right side of the fairway. He decided he was going to find that ball and play it no matter where it lay. It took him an hour and a half before he finally located that ball way out of the woods, perched atop the tallest anthill he had ever seen. It was about 6 feet tall. He decided he would play it right there, so he trudged to the top of the anthill, murdering 120,000 ants beneath his feet as he climbed. He aimed, swung, missed the ball completely, took a huge divot out of the mound, and killed another 40,000 ants with that one swing. Undaunted, he aimed again, swung, missed the ball completely, killed another 35,000 ants. 27 swings later, this guy has still failed to touch the ball, but has created the worst ant massacre in ant history. Millions of ants lie dead or dying at his feet. You can even hear their relatives crying way down in the mound. Finally, it's magic. Finally, in the midst of the massacre, two ants crawled up out of the mound. They watched this idiot taking swing after swing, murdering all of their friends and relatives. And finally, one ant turned to the other and said, you know, if we don't get on the ball, we're going to die. If you don't get on the ball with regard to motives, attitude, focus, and expectations, you won't die physically. But you will come to work every day feeling dead inside. You will go through the motions of your job like a zombie. You will experience your career as a dead-end job instead of what it ought to be. An ever-expanding, thrilling adventure in changing lives. So you guys go get them. You have a fabulous year. Do whatever it takes to make a difference in the lives of those kids. Thank you so much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in one round of applause for our team of disillusionists, Mr. Billy Ray.
Congratulations, Mr. Chavez. At this time, I would like to take you all back to a couple months ago when a very special teacher was very recognized for her extraordinary skills. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome to the stage Eagle Pass Independent School District 2015-2016 Teacher of the Year from Sam Houston, Ms. Rosa Ochoa.
Be the teacher of the year. Being teacher of the year is something anyone can accomplish because all it takes is having the love for your profession. And people have asked what it takes to be teacher of the year. I have questioned myself too. But looking back at my career, I realized it takes passion, dedication, and lots of sacrifice. I would not be able to live out my passion every day if it were not for my family. I would like to thank my husband and my children for being supportive and letting me do what I love to do. They understand my early mornings, after school activities, and late night planning. That's only my teacher duties. Don't get me started on mom duties. For those of you that do not know me, I do have 5 kids. Thank you to my principal, Mrs. Rojas. And our IO, Mr. Flores. And of course, my colleagues. I have been very blessed in working with amazing staff at Sam Houston Elementary for the past 8 years. We have laughed, cried, and supported each other along the way, and it has not been an easy ride. Last but not least, I thank God for giving me the perseverance to go that extra mile. I am extremely honored and humbled to be EPISD's Teacher of the Year. I dedicate this honor to our campus and our students who inspire me to be the best that I can be. Let's have an amazing year. And teachers, don't forget to show your evidence. Go Cougars!
School District will be hosting its first annual Most Spirited School Competition. The purpose of this competition is to rally district morale and increase opportunities for the students and teachers to showcase their school's individual talents. There are great things happening in our district, and now is the time for for everyone to see it. Today marks the beginning of the competition, and when you hear your school's name and see your logo hit that screen, I want you to give it everything you got. Remember, no confetti cannons or silly screens, but come out and show up. Ladies and gentlemen, let the games begin.
Better be this elementary. Welcome to the spectrum of challenges!
New beginnings!
New successes!
We are ready
for 2016-2017 school year.
Here at Perfecto Mancha,
our students will strive for success!
We are the Mighty
Mancha! People are getting stressed in here. Let's send it back to the back. Grace?
Thank you.
que nos hace que la vida es una hermosura. Hay que vivirla todo, que se siente que se solo el que está mal. Tienes que saber que no es así, que la vida no es nadie solo. Siempre hay alguien más que llorar. Que la vida es un carnaval.
Thank you very much. hold the camera. And then, can you see yourself?
Uh-huh.
So play that music so loud. Oh, what was it?
No. Show me how you dance now.
Show me how you dance now.
Oh, okay.
Play that music too loud. There you go. We're doing this, ma'am. Ma'am, we're doing this.
We're going down.
We're going down. And we're doing this. Welcome to my house, and that's it.
Okay. Our house.
Our house.
Our house.
Our house.
The two
guys.
The two guys.
You want
to start it
here? You know what? Woo! Welcome to my house. All right, let's do it again. No, he's so bad. That's because you've been shining, ma'am. And then.
Okay, so we're getting it at night. I'm exhausted.
Benny, you like being in front of the camera? How do you like to?
And then you have
to
put your
shoulders on. Kimberly's mom taught me when I used to do my
model. Go! Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for your admin. At this time, I'd like to thank you all for coming. Please report back to your home campuses. And thank you for a lovely ceremony.
Mm-hmm.